Hey, what's going on there, guys? Nick here from Absolute MTG, and today we're going to be taking a look at 4-color burn for the modern format. So, with the addition of Khans of Tark here, Modern got two really sweet cards. The two cards are Monastery Swift Spear and Treasure Cruise, and where Monastery Swift Spear kind of makes sense, where it would fit into like a mono red deck, you're casting all of these burn spells and stuff, and your Monastery Swift Spear gets bigger, and then you're swinging with it. Treasure Cruise doesn't seem like it's something that would fit in. It seems like a card that would fit into Delver. It works with Delver because you're using cards that you're casting and stuff that's in your grave. You're turning that into raw card power, and you're drawing more. But in this type of a deck, it actually works out pretty well because we're running so many fetch lands in this deck that we're able to put our fetch lands into our grave with that searching for our shock lands that will allow us to play our additional colors that we're splashing for. We're able to cast our burn spells and deal damage to our opponent, and then we're able to actually delve into our Treasure Cruise, draw extra cards, and be able to finish off our opponent where... Sometimes with other burn decks, if you're playing like just straight mono red burn, or even like mono red burn, splash a color like white or splash a color like black, sometimes you just tend to run out of steam. So if your opponent's playing like discard spells or anything like that, if you're playing against the mid-range decks and they're ticking up Liliana, forcing you to discard and all you're discarding are burn spells, or they're playing Inquisition or something against you, sometimes you tend to run out of resources. And Treasure Cruise is pretty much like the best way to fill up your hand with a bunch of cards, and then you're able to just kind of keep the game going and finish off your opponent pretty quickly. With the remaining colors that we have, because we've pretty much covered red and blue here as far as Treasure Cruise and like the typical red spells you're concerned, the remaining colors are white and green. So. With white, we're able to play cards like Boros Charm and Khor Firewalker, which seems like a kind of weird card to be playing in a burn deck, but we'll get to explaining why this card actually works in the sideboard. And we're able to play Destructive Revelry, so Destructive Revelry, of course, being a little bit better than Smash the Smithereens because it can hit enchantments, but at the downside of it, it does cost one green mana on top of the red that it costs, and it's only dealing two damage. But to jump into the actual deck and to cover the cards that we're playing here. So our first card is Goblin Guide, typical card that you would imagine pretty much every mono red burn deck or red burn variant is going to be playing. It's a 2/2 for one red. It has haste, and whenever it attacks, your opponent's going to reveal the top card of their library. If it's a land, they get to put it into their hand. So that's the only downside to Goblin Guide. Is your opponent could potentially draw some extra cards off of it, but being able to hit your opponent on turn one for two damage and still have that Goblin Guide there and swing every turn is still pretty sweet. We have a playset of Monastery Swift Spear, so 1/2 for one red. Easily one of my more favorite cards out of Khans of Tark here. It's just such a sweet card. Haste Prowess. So with Prowess, it's going to get +1/+1 for each non-creature spell that we are going to cast. So our Monastery Swift Spear can potentially be bigger than our Goblin Guide, and much bigger than it, in fact. However, it doesn't have the downside that Goblin Guide has with your opponent potentially drawing extra cards. Goblin Guide, of course, whenever it fails to find a land for your opponent, you do see what's on top of their library, so there is kind of that little trade-off there, but still, the Monastery Swift Spear is only a 1/2 for that one red, but it potentially can get much bigger than the Goblin Guide as far as power is concerned. We have a playset of Eidolon of the Great Revel, so 2/2 for a double red. Whenever a player casts a spell with converted mana cost 3 or less, Eidolon of the Great Revel is going to deal 2 damage to that player. Now, it is a little bit counterintuitive for us, just because we are playing so many spells that are 3 converted mana cost or less. However, for our opponents that are playing anything like counter spells, or they're playing their own spells that are converted mana cost 3 or less, they're going to be taking a ton of damage. And the card is especially good in the actual mirror match. So in the mirror match, your opponent's going to be taking a bunch of damage off the Eidolon if they don't get rid of it soon. But the Eidolon is pretty great just because the modern format is so inundated with spells that are 3 or less mana, and usually the card ends up being very, very valuable in most matchups. So for our burn spells, we have Lightning Bolt, which you guys could imagine, 1 red, deal 3 damage to target creature or player. We have Shard Volley, which is kind of like Lightning Bolt, only we have to actually sacrifice a land as an additional cost to it, which sacrificing the land, it puts another card in our graveyard, we can delve with it. But 1 red, deals 3 damage to target creature or player at instant speed. We have Lava Spike, again, pretty much a Lightning Bolt, however, this one is a sorcery speed card, and it's only going to be able to deal damage to a player, so deals 3 damage to target player for 1 red. We have Searing Blaze, which is double red, and it deals 1 damage to target player and 1 damage to target creature that player controls, but with landfall, if we had a land enter the battlefield this turn, instead it's going to deal 3 damage to the player and 3 damage to that creature instead. One thing that's interesting about Searing Blaze, and I think that people forget about it, is if you have like a 4 toughness creature, like let's say your opponent has like a 4 toughness Tarmogoyf and they're at 3, you can still use the Searing Blaze and be able to deal the damage to your opponent. A lot of people forget that it doesn't necessarily have to kill the creature. You just need to have a target for the Searing Blaze actually to be able to deal the damage to your opponent. But Searing Blaze is pretty awesome. It's kind of one of those cards that's pretty easy to side out if it doesn't end up working for you. Like if you're playing up against a matchup like Blue White Red Control where you don't really have as many targets, it's a card that you can just kind of easily swap out for something out of your sideboard. We have a playset of Skullcrack, so 2 mana, and players can't gain life this turn, damage can't be prevented this turn, and it deals 3 damage to target player. So the Skullcrack is good whenever your opponent's trying to do things like Kitchen Finks entering the battlefield, or them like potting off their Kitchen Finks to be able to search with Birthing Pod into something else and the Persist trigger happening. There are a lot of different instances within the format and with a lot of different decks where your opponent can gain life, even like Scavenging Ooze. So whenever your opponent's trying to gain life, you can respond with Skullcrack and you can shut off their life gain for the turn, and then you can easily get in for that 3 damage. We have a playset of Boros Charm, so one of the reasons to actually be playing white here. Another reason would be Lightning Helix, however, it's not really as necessary. It is a perfectly viable thing to be playing within this deck. You could easily cut something like Searing Blaze to be able to play Lightning Helix. However, for the purpose of this deck and for what I've actually been playing, I haven't been playing the Helix, only just the Boros Charm. But Boros Charm, 1 red and 1 white, it can deal 4 damage to target player, or we can have our permanents become indestructible until the end of the turn, or we can give a creature double strike until the end of the turn. So the Boros Charm is sweet because Monastery Swift Spear can get double strike and we can deal a whole lot based on that prowess. The dealing 4 damage is just great as a burn spell on its own for 2 mana. And the indestructible isn't really as useful for us. Sometimes it might be, it really just depends on a very narrow situation, but usually Boros Charm, you're either dealing 4 damage or you're giving your Swift Spear double strike. And then we're coming to Treasure Cruise. So Treasure Cruise, 7 and 1 blue, delve and draw 3 cards. So getting rid of some stuff out of our graveyard, getting rid of our spells, any creatures that we may have lost based on combat or like removal spells that our opponents have, our fetch lands, lands that we sacked off of Shard Volley, all of that's going to get delved away and we're going to be able to draw 3 cards. Another reason why Treasure Cruise is really sweet in this deck is we don't kind of auto-fold to Tarmogoyf, because Tarmogoyf is kind of a big thing. Like, you don't really have a efficient burn spell to be able to get rid of Tarmogoyf unless it's just really, really small. But the Treasure Cruise is able to get stuff out of our graveyard, so our opponent's only going to be basing their power and toughness of their Tarmogoyf based on what they have in their actual graveyard themselves on top of our Treasure Cruise, which will constitute a sorcery in our grave. And then for the fetch lands that we're playing, I'm playing 10 fetch lands. It doesn't matter which ones you're playing as long as they're red. So any 10 red fetch lands, they could be Wooded Foothills, Bloodstained Mire, Scalding Tarns, or Arid Mesas, whatever. For this deck, I'm playing 4 Scalding Tarns, 4 Arid Mesa, and 2 Bloodstained Mire. So yeah, any 10 red fetch lands And then for the Shocklands that we're playing two Steam Vents, two Sacred Foundry, and one Stomping Ground. And it works out pretty well. The double white's a little bit awkward whenever you're trying to get the core Firewalker, but with the amount of fetch lands that you're actually playing in this deck, because you're playing 10 of them and you're only running 20 lands, it's very easy to be able to fetch up like double white, or even to just find a fetch land to be able to get your treasure cruise online or anything like that. And then we have five basic mountains. So for the sideboard here, the first card that we have is Searing Blood. So Searing Blood is a little bit more narrow of a card than like Searing Blaze is. I'm sure you don't have to worry about landfall and like fetching on your opponent's turn or anything like that. But Searing Blood is more for those narrow decks where your opponent is playing those creatures that are like two toughness. So it's really good against the Delver decks because you can hit Delver of Secrets, you can hit Young Pyromancer, you can hit Snapcaster Mage, cards like that. It's really good for those types of decks, and anything that you may catch on to that your opponent's playing that like just has a really low toughness. The Searing Blood's great for that. It deals the 3 damage if that creature is going to die during this turn, and you get a little bit of value out of a removal spell, so to say. We have 2 Torpor Orbs, so creatures entering the battlefield don't cause abilities to trigger. Mainly, this is going to be for the decks that are going to try to combo off. So, like the pod combos, it's really good to stop those. And it's really good for Splinter Twin. That's pretty much like the biggest thing with Torpor Orb, is just being able to shut off those types of decks and give us a little bit of time to actually be able to burn out our opponent. We have 3 Molten Rain, so destroy target land. If that land is non-basic, it deals 2 damage to that land's controller. And it's for 3 mana at a sorcery speed. So Molten Rain is for like Tron, basically. Tron really doesn't pop up as much as it used to. However, Molten Rain is still really useful for decks like Blue White Red Control. You can throw them off of being able to use their Celestial Colonnade, or even just throw them off of their dual lands that they're actually playing. And it's also somewhat useful for like the other really greedy mana bases that you may play against, like Jund, or even like playing against Junk mid-range, or Abzan mid-range, I guess if you want to call it. Playing against decks that have a really greedy mana base, Molten Rain's really good, and if you have any dead cards, like Searing Blaze ends up being a little bit dead in some matchups, so the Molten Rain is kind of like a easy audible into. And then we have Destructive Revelry. So Destructive Revelry is a 4/4 in the sideboard. 1 red and 1 green, destroy target artifact or enchantment, it deals 2 damage to that permanent's controller. So really this is going to be like, if you're playing against Infinity, this is like a auto 4 of include. If you're playing against a deck like Splinter Twin, it's a card that you can easily side in as well. Like the 2 Torpor Orbs and like at least 2 Destructive Revelry are going to be somewhat useful for you and are pretty much going to get the job done. Playing against Splinter Twin, you just have to be careful of how you're actually playing the Destructive Revelry, because if your opponent goes and actually puts the Splinter Twin on their creature, and as soon as like that resolves and they pass priority to you, you play Destructive Revelry, they can go infinite. They can just make infinite dudes in response, and then they can go to combat and just beat you. So you have to be a little bit more careful with this removal card for enchantments as far as timing is concerned and when to actually use it for removal on a Splinter Twin. And then the last card that we have in here is Core Firewalker. So Core Firewalker is a 2/2 for double white, protection from red. Whenever a player casts a red spell, you may gain 1 life. So the reason why Core Firewalker is so awesome in the sideboard for this deck is because normally whenever you're playing a mono red deck, the sideboard options that you're going to have to actually be able to play against the mirror match, you're really just going to be pitted with playing Dragon's Claw. So whenever your opponent plays a card or plays a red spell, you're going to gain 1 life. Whenever you play a red spell, you're going to gain 1 life. Core Firewalker is a lot better for us because we're already being so greedy with our mana base. We're playing the 10 fetch lands that are going to power our treasure cruise and are going to allow us to mana fix very heavily. The core Firewalker is awesome because it sits on the battlefield, it has protection from red, and it blocks opposing Goblin Guides, Swift Spears, and Eidolons of the Great Rebel, which is just really enormous most times. But even whenever the core Firewalker isn't blocking, if you don't have to block anything with the Firewalker, it itself is going to be able to actually get in and deal some damage. So it's really like Dragon's Claw with legs. That's pretty much what it ends up being. The core Firewalker is a little bit awkward with like the double white, but as I've explained in the past, like because you're playing so many fetch lands and all of your fetch lands are going to be able to fetch for anything that is a mountain, it's not really that hard to fetch up two Sacred Foundries. Sure, you're going to be taking a little bit of damage doing so, but having a creature that can block your opponents like Swift Spears and also gain you some life is really awesome. So that is our deck tech here for four color burn, the very greedy alternative to like mono red burn in Modern. It's a really sweet deck. It's not the easiest to afford as far as like fetch lands and dual lands go with this deck, but if you're able to build it, it's definitely a whole lot of fun. I highly recommend you guys try it, even if you're playing it on Cockatrice or something like that. It's a whole lot of fun to actually play. And if you guys enjoyed this video, I'd appreciate it if you thumbs up the video and subscribe to the channel for more Magic the Gathering content. Until next time, guys, peace out.
If you guys want to keep up to date with everything that we have going on here at Absolute MTG, remember to hit that subscribe button, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter for all of your Magic the Gathering needs. Also, remember to check out our sponsors of the channel, MTG Madness and AVUGames.com. But as always, thank you guys for watching.